The Joe Rogan Experience.
It was a fake video that I sent Jamie today. These motherfuckers, they keep getting me. There's a new fake video.
I think that was the same one. I think someone just took another clip from it.
Oh, is it?
Those guys have been making VFX videos on YouTube for 10 plus years. They're really good at it.
So it's so good.
For people who don't know, there's a YouTube channel where people, I think it's a single YouTube channel that does like, visual effects, like fake humanoid or robot dog. Robots that kind of resemble something like Boston Dynamics but they do some crazy stuff with guns.
This one, they gave the robot a gun and pull it up, Jamie. What is the gentleman?
Corridor Digital on YouTube is the guys that make it. Crew is the YouTube channel, I think.
Fucking incredible that it's not real. It looks so real. And so the robot, they kick it, they hit it with a hockey helmet or a hockey stick, rather.
Is there like long video they made a while ago? They might have made a new one. Which was one out in the desert, but I think I had seen it before.
I see they trick you with the Boston Dynamics. It's Boss Town.
Boss Town Dynamics.
It looks so realistic. But here's the thing: we're not that far off from this thing.
No, okay. Let's walk it back. It's not realistic.
In what way?
So it looks human realistic. So you can tell it's a human. Like a robotics person could tell it's a human. Because it's really difficult to do that kind of motion, that kind of movement.
Oh, like when it's getting shot?
Well, not the getting shot. So there's a lot of movement it does for the purpose of comedy.
Right.
Like it actually is on purpose trying to look like a human for the comedic internet effect, like getting a human that's getting pissed off and so on.
Yes.
Those qualities are like another order of magnitude.
Like this here, where it's like, give me that. Come on, guys. Oh, come on.
So for a Terminator. Oh. Yeah. doing Bruce Lee type of movements. Some of those are just comedic. You know, you don't need Terminator type robot.
Do have legitimate robots that can do backflips now and do.
So it's really a backflip, like parkour.
This one's real.
This is all real. It's manipulation. So all of these robots, depending on what we're talking about here, but those are remote controlled. And these are single demonstrations that they've perfected. So it's really important to distinguish between the body of the robot and the brain of the robot. So these bodies, unlike anything else, unlike a Roomba, unlike a drone, who can also be very threatening, these bodies somehow, we anthropomorphize them and they terrify us. I don't know what it is. I met Spot Mini in person. That was one of the most transformative moments in my life.
Really?
Because I know how dumb it is, but the experience of it, like, it's not even a head. It's supposed to be a hand, but it looks like a head. And it, like, looking up at me with that hand, I felt like I was, like it was magic. It was like Frankenstein coming to life. It was this moment of creation. And what I realized is my own brain sort of anthropomorphizing. The same way you're like looking at these robots and you're thinking these things are terrifying.
Yeah.
Like what's like, you know, in 10, 20 years, where are we going to be?
Yeah.
That's our brain playing tricks on us. Because the key thing that's a threat to humanity or an exciting possibility for humanity is the intelligence of the robots, the brains, the mind. And these robots have very, very little intelligence. So in terms of being able to perceive and understand the world, very importantly, to learn about the world from scratch. So the terrifying thing is, you talked often like with this sort of philosophical kind of notion that Sam Harris talks about, sort of exponential improvement, be able to become human level intelligence, superhuman level intelligence, in a matter of days, become more intelligent than that. That's all learning process. That's being able to learn. That's the key aspect. We're in the very early days of that. There's an idea of, you know, Big Bang is a funny word for one of the most fundamental ideas in the nature of our universe. Same way, self-play is a term for, I think, one of the most important, powerful ideas in artificial intelligence that people are currently working on. So self-play. I don't know if you're familiar with a company called DeepMind and OpenAI, so Google DeepMind, and a game. I know you're a first-person shooter guy, but StarCraft and Dota 2. So last year, these are, what do you call them, real-time strategy, I guess, and people win millions of dollars in esport competitions. And so OpenAI separately had OpenAI 5, which took on Dota 2. Dota 2 is the computer game based on Warcraft 3. That's the most popular esport game. And then DeepMind took on StarCraft with their AlphaStar system. And the key amazing thing is there, similar to AlphaGo and AlphaZero that learned to play Go, is the mechanism of self-play. That's the exciting mechanism that I think if we can figure out how to have an impact on more serious problems than games would be transformative. Okay, what is it? It's learning from scratch in a competitive environment. So thinking of, you have two white belts, going to jiu-jitsu, you have two white belts training against each other and trying to figure out how to beat each other without ever having black belt supervision, instructors, and so on, and slowly getting better that way, coming up, inventing new moves that way. And eventually, they get better and better by that competitive process. That's the machine playing itself without human supervision. The interesting thing is there's a lot of cases in which if you set up the competitive environment well enough for those two white belts, they'll learn to be black belts. They'll learn to be not only black belts, they'll learn to be better than, like, exactly the kind of evolution that's happening in MMA right now. If you put that in a digital space and speed it up, you know, a millionfold, it'll continue to improve.
Let me pause you here, because this is one of the things that I think probably translates to AI as it does to jiu-jitsu. You need more than one opponent. Like, you can't have one input. One person training with one person specifically and singularly, you're not going to develop the type of game that you need to become a real black belt in jiu-jitsu.
100%. Exactly. Yeah. So that's part of the brilliance of this mechanism. So imagine you didn't just have white belts. You had an opportunity to generate a new random white belt, like a fat, big one, mm-hmm. a little one,
right,
and all kinds of different one that an loves aggressive weed one. Named Eddie Bravo.
A passive one.
And let them play. And then mm-hmm. so it's what you find is, like, jiu-jitsu might be simpler than the general problem sort of different kind of like StarCraft and so on. But there is sets of strategies in this giant space. There are these complex hierarchical strategies, like high-level strategies and then specifics of different moves that emerge, some of which you didn't even realize existed. And that requires that you start with a huge amounts of random initial states, like the fat person, the skinny person, the aggressive person, and so on. And then you also keep injecting randomness in the system, so you discover new ideas. So even when you reach purple belt, you don't continue with those same people. You start your own school. You start expanding to totally random new ideas and expanding this way. And what you find out is there's totally surprising to human beings, like in the game of chess or in the game of Go, in the game of StarCraft. This self-play mechanism can do what sort of AI people have dreamed of, which is be creative. Create totally new behaviors, totally new strategies that are surprising to human experts.
That's why Go was so astounding to them, right? Because it's such a complex game.
Such a hard game. And it's able to, well, the first astounding thing, it's able to beat the world champion. The second astounding thing about both chess and Go is it's able to create totally new ideas. Sort of, I'm not good enough at chess or Go to understand the newness of them, but grandmasters talk about the way AlphaZero plays chess, and they say there's a lot of brilliant, interesting ideas there, like very counterintuitive ideas. And that's all, the first breakthroughs didn't have as much self-play. They were trained on human experts, but AlphaZero and AlphaStar and OpenAI 5, these systems are all fundamentally self-play, meaning no human supervision, starting from scratch. So no black belt instructor, and that means, so they learning from scratch, that's exceptionally powerful. That's a process from zero, you can get to superhuman level intelligence in a particular task in a matter of days. Like, that's super powerful, super exciting, super terrifying, if that's kind of what you think about. The challenge is we don't know how to do that in the physical space. In the space of robots, there's something fundamentally different about being able to perceive, to understand this environment, to do common sense reasoning. the thing we really take for granted is our ability to reason about the physics of the world, about the fact that things weigh things, that you can stack things on top of each other, the fact that some things are hard, some things are soft, some things are painful when you touch them. All that, like, there seems to be a giant Wikipedia inside our brain of, like, common sense, dumb logic that's very tough to build up. It seems to be an exceptionally difficult learning problem that Boston Dynamics will have to solve in order to achieve even the same kind of physical movement behavior that we saw in those videos. And then on top of that, to have the ethical behavior, the objective, the complex strategies involved in first following orders and then getting frustrated and then shooting everybody. That's an exceptionally difficult thing to arrive at, because ultimately these systems operate on a set of objectives. And what a lot of people that think about artificial general intelligence say, the objectives we need to inject in these systems that they're trained on need to have, one, uncertainty. So they should always doubt themselves. Just like if you want to be a good black belt, you should always be sort of always open-minded, sort of relax, always need to learn techniques. It's okay to get submitted. So always always have a degree of uncertainty about your worldview, the kind of thing we criticized Twitter outrage mobs for not having. So having uncertainty. And the other thing is always have a place where there should be human supervision. And I think we have good mechanisms for that in place that I think I'm very optimistic about where these kinds of learning systems can take us. The exciting thing is Boston Dynamics, well, terrifying, depending on whether you think I'm a trustworthy human being, but Boston Dynamics is now opening up their platform. So they're working with a few people. Quite busy these days, but I'm trying to make time to make it happen, to work with them, to build stuff on top of the platform. So, sorry, I'm referring to Spot Mini as a platform. So this robot is this dumb, it's like a Roomba. It's a dumb mechanistic thing that can move for you. But you can add a brain on top of it. So you can make it learn, you can make it see the world and so on. That's all extra. That's not what Boston Dynamics offers. So they want to work with people like me to add that kind of capability. And that's exciting because now you can have hundreds of people start to add interesting learning capabilities. And so I may have to retract my words about how far away we are with the capabilities of these robots once you now open up to the internet. So I was speaking to Boston Dynamics. I think they're solving the really hard robotics problem. But once you open it up to the huge world of researchers that are doing machine learning and doing computer vision and doing AI research, the kind of capabilities that might add to these robots might surprise us.
That's where people are concerned, right? The big leaps.
The big leaps,
and then sort of just not being aware of the consequences of these big leaps. And once you let the genie out of the bottle, you can never put it back.
Right. The genie and the self-play mechanism where you grow from zero to becoming world-class chess player. That's the genie being out of the bottle.